Hello friends, a control valve, also called the final control element, is the last statement in the PID control loop, which manipulates the process variable to bring the measured variable at set point as fast as possible after any process disturbance. Assuming everything is okay in control loop, if my control valve is not responding the way I expect, then my control loop going to be unstable for sure. Ideally, this is expected to move as exactly the way as the control signal varies from 0 to 100%. Even it should matches the speed and rate at which control signal changes, or otherwise lead lag errors may be introduced. And these errors cause the measured variable to oscillate around the set point. The process of synchronizing the need of a control loop with a control valve is called selecting or sizing a control valve. Unfortunately, it is a lost art these days. While preparing a control valve, most engineers provide the process data to the vendor, and vendor puts the data in a software program or some Excel sheet. That program simply spits out some random result, and that's it. If you want to check if existing control valves in your plant are rightly sized or not, there is a very simple, easy method I will tell you now. Next time you visit your control loop, just observe the control valves, which are operating below 20% or above 80% most of the time. Particularly those control valves which are being operated with a PID controller. If any of these control valves are operating below 20%, declare these as oversized. And if these are operating above 80%, declare those as undersized. So simple. And you know, control room operators can guide you well and tell you what are the exact problem associated with these undersized or oversized valves. The problem with the undersized control valve is it cannot pass the required flow when required by the PI controller for any big disturbance encountered in process. And the control valve does not have margin to supply the flow to counter that disturbance as it is already 80% open. And reverse is the case with the oversized control valve. Even the smallest change in the valve position causes a big change in flow as it only 20% or less is open. The problem associated with incorrect sizing causes the PID control loop to be unstable, even after spending long hours on PID tuning session. Theoretically, a perfectly tuned PID controller is designed to operate a control valve at 50% position. But practically, load conditions are not perfect. So a control loop gets stable condition anywhere between 20 to 80% position. For various load condition, as you must have seen in process. So here we can conclude that 20 to 80% range is a practical chosen range for a control valve to operate. This is the range where a PID loop performs better. So this is the first criteria. You can identify or select a control valve that is rightly sized. Actually, my point is a control valve is supposed to be correctly sized if it delivering required flow at its 50% position when process is operating at its normal capacity. There must be a margin on both sides, that is closed and open side, to tackle or handle any big disturbance if a process encounters. This range is chosen from 20 to 80% for a well-stable PID control loop. So when you are going for a control valve sizing, make sure you must know the normal flow of liquid or gas or flood plus the extra margin added to the flow. Choosing capacity. A valve capacity is denoted by CV, a coefficient. A valve with CV of 10 will allow you to flow 10 gallon per minute of water with a pressure drop of 1 psi at 60 degree Fahrenheit temperature. The bigger the value of C, the more will be the flow with a 1 psi drop across it. To know how this CV is derived, we need to understand what happens when a flood passes through a control valve. Actually, the flow regulation and control is accomplished by varying the resistance of flow through it with a plug seat opening closing arrangement. When the flood passes through this opening, its velocity increases, but at the expense of loss of pressure energy. As per Bernoulli's law, we have read about, we can compare this phenomena similar to orifice plate we inserted in pipeline to measure DP across it to know the measurement of flow. You can see the pressure and velocity profile over this screen behind. As the flood passes from the upstream side at P1 pressure and V1 velocity, through the point of restriction, also called the vena contacta, this vena contacta resembles the plug seat opening in control valve. At this point, flood velocity reaches to a maximum and its pressure falls to minimum. Beyond the vena contractor point, the flux velocity decreases as the diameter of restriction increases. It causes flood to recover some of the pressure energy and lose velocity energy. This is best described by the quantity equation, as you can see on the screen. Here V is mean velocity and A is flow area. This equation concludes that velocity and of course the pressure can be changed by adjusting the valve opening area. Now let's turn back to control valve discussion again. Now for sizing a control valve, we are basically interested to know that how much flow we can get for a given opening of the valve and for any given pressure differential. This relationship is expressed by flow coefficient CV. Here you can see the Q is flow rate and G is the constant, P1, P2 is the upstream and downstream pressure. Now this equation shows that flow rate varies from square root of the differential pressure across the control valve. Greater the pressure drop, higher will be the flow rate. And pressure drop across a valve is a function of area, shape, path and roughness of valve. So a CV will help you to size a control valve for a flow required in your process. Now choosing flow characteristic. It simply tells you how the flow rate will change or in what pattern or format it will change, in what relation it will change with the valve stream or valve opening. There may be three characteristics which are encountered in a CV, say you can use. These are on-off valve and regulating throttling, or third is the emergency or safety valve. Different valve characterization can be achieved by different valve trim shapes. Here we can discuss more of one. These are linear. As the name suggests, this type of control valve characteristic causes flow capacity to increase linearly with the valve travel. The linear flow characteristic has a constant slope, which means the valve of this type has a constant gain through the complete range of flow from 0 to 100 PM. This characteristic is achieved with the plug shown on the screen. This is used where a process is supposed to be slow, where the pressure drop across the valve is expected to remain fairly constant. For example, we have level control, flow control loops. And next one is equal percentage. Here flow capacity increases exponentially with the valve trim or the valve opening, which means equal increments of valve travel produces equal percentage change in existing CV. This type of valve is commonly used in temperature and pressure control loop application, where large changes in pressure drop are expected immediately. Quick opening. These valves give you a large increment in flow for relatively smaller valve opening. Additional increase in valve travel gives sharply reduced changes in flow rate. It almost gives you maximum flow rate at minimum travel. That is 75% flow you can achieve in 25% stroke. The plug used for the same may depict the behavior of the quick opening. These valve usually used for on-off service application, that is flare valve, safety valve, cooling water system. So here the maximum CV can be obtained quickly. To get the desired characteristic, one must specify the material construction and seat plug material details. Apart from you know all the discussed parameters, you must also know what this control valve has to do in process control. Let's discuss the situation wise. Situation wise, always know your control method. If you need tight control or loose control, that is with you. Tight control lets you control within a tight margin across a range of process condition. And loose control lets you throttle around a set point to avoid overshoot basically. A control valve is the last piece of equipment that ensures the stability of a control system. The requirement for one situation are quite different from the other. And a poorly sized and selected control valve will make tight control impossible, regardless of control strategy or tuning you employed there. So selecting the right valve matters. Now situation 2. Do you need a tight shutoff or need throttling for a PID control loop? A valve cannot do both functions. If you need both, then you have to add a separate on-off shutoff valve in the pipeline. So know your need first. And one most important criteria I must tell you at first is this fail-safe mode operation. What my process need is when the power to the actuator fails or anybody presses the emergency button. In this condition, if it is to be open or closed, well, you should know. Now, if the power, their power may be electric, hydraulic, pneumatic, whatever it is. If the control valve is open right now and suddenly power fails, what is to be done next? You want to keep it open or need to close? Here the term comes air to open, air to close. As per process need, you have to select the mode of operation if the power to the actuator fails. Here, most spring loaded pneumatic control valves are used for quick opening or shutting the during the emergency hours. Spring action provides the power to close or open to make your process safe. Now comes actuator. A valve actuator is a device that produces a force to open or close the valve. Pneumatic one. The pneumatic actuator utilizes the air signal from the external control device to create a control action via positioner or a solenoid. The main benefit of using a pneumatic actuator is that almost it takes only a second to close or open fully. A valve positioner device is used mostly with a pneumatic actuator, which ensures the exact positioning of the control valve as per the control signal by using actual movement of valve stem as per feedback to the valve positioner. The addition of a positioner can correct many variations, including changes in packing friction due to dirt, corrosion or lack of lubrication, and variation in dynamic forces of the process. A positioner may be used as a signal amplifier or booster. It accepts a low pressure air signal and by using its own higher pressure input, multiplies this to provide a higher pressure output air signal to the actuator diaphragm. While electric actuators are motor driven basically devices that uses gearboxes which further drive the valve stem and plug assembly for process variable modulation. So it takes a lot of time to open or close fully. So you cannot get quick open or shut off responses which is desired for emergency situation. And that's why you find pneumatic actuators are still in use in industry. This also provides safety against fire hazards, inflammable environment. As far as maintenance is concerned, electric actuators are far better than pneumatic actuator, which requires dry cleaning air all the time. Sure, we will have a separate video on actuator and positioner part as it carries its own mechanics. Its function is to move only plug seat arrangement. Friends, as control valve being the final control element responsible for correct input to process to maintain some process parameter, it needs due consideration before selecting and sizing as per requirement. So consider all the facts discussed in this video. If you need any assistance or some queries regarding control valve, you can post in comment section. Sure, we will discuss and come out with a possible solution. Till then, goodbye, take care, keep sharing videos.